The Overlooked Role of White Female Slave Owners by Becky Little. Most Americans know that George Washington owned enslaved people at his Mount Vernon home, but fewer probably know that it was his wife, Martha, who dramatically increased the enslaved population there. When they wed in 1759, George may have owned around 18 people. Martha, one of the richest women in Virginia, owned 84. The high number of people Martha Washington owned is unusual, but the fact that she owned them is not. Stephanie E. Jones Rogers, a history professor at the University of California, Berkeley, is compiling data on just how many white women owned slaves in the US. And in the parts of the 1850 and 1860 census data she studied so far, white women make up about 40% of all slave owners. Slaveholding parents typically gave their daughters more enslaved people than land, says Jones Rogers, whose book, They Were Property, White Women as Slave Owners in the American South, came out in February 2019. What this means is that their very identities as white Southern women were tied to the actual or the possible ownership of other people. White women were active and violent participants in the slave market. They bought, sold, managed, and sought the return of enslaved people in whom they had vested in economic interest. Owning a large number of enslaved people made a woman a better marriage prospect. Once married, white women fought in courts to preserve their legal ownership over enslaved people, as opposed to their husband's ownership, and often won. For them, slavery was their freedom, Jones Rogers observes in her book. They were her property upends a lot of older scholarship. For example, previous scholars have argued that most Southern white women didn't buy, sell, or inflict violence on enslaved people because this was considered improper for them. But Jones Rogers argues that white women were actually trained to participate from a very young age. Their exposure to the slave market is not something that begins in adulthood. It begins in their homes when they're little girls, sometimes infants, when they're given enslaved people as gifts, she says. Citing interviews with formerly enslaved people that the Works Project Progress Administration, a New Deal agency, conducted in the 1930s, Jones Rogers shows that part of white children's training in plantation management involved beating enslaved people. It didn't matter whether the child was large or small, one woman told the WPA. They always beat you till the blood ran down. As adults, white women often tore black women away from their babies so they could nurse the white mistress's baby instead. To this end, white women placed thousands of advertisements in newspapers looking for enslaved wet nurses to feed their own children and created a huge market for enslaved black women who had recently given birth. Why did these white women want black women to nurse their children? One complained she felt like continuously having children and continuously nursing her children made her a slave to her children. That's an actual quote, Jones Rogers says. Some black women reported in WPA interviews that their mothers would always give birth around the same time as their white mistress, suggesting these mistresses were also orchestrating the sexual assault of enslaved women. There were instances in which formerly enslaved people did in fact say that their mistresses either sanctioned acts of sexual violence against them that were perpetuated at the hands of white men, or that they orchestrated instances of sexual violence between two enslaved people that they owned in hopes of producing children from these acts of sexual violence, Jones Rogers says. White women also fought to maintain the wealth and free labor that slavery provided them through the Civil War. As Union troops made their way through the South freeing enslaved people, white women would move enslaved people farther from the soldiers' path. One woman, Martha Gibbs, even took enslaved people to Texas and forced them to work for her at gunpoint until 1866, a year after slavery's formal abolition. After the Civil War, Southern white women sought to recreate slavery through the exploitative work contracts. Some also wrote books portraying the institution of slavery as gentle and benign, the most famous being Gone with the Wind by Margaret Mitchell, a woman born 35 years after abolition. Yet as Jones Rogers argues in her book, it was not only white women's ideological and sentimental connections to slavery that made them defend it. Scarlett O'Hara would have also been protecting her economic interests too. Ona Judge, slave and Martha Washington's personal servant. The slave Ona Judge was Martha Washington's chief personal attendant for 7 years. But rather than remain the first lady's servant, she ran away in 1796. Ona Judge was Martha Washington's chief attendant from about 1789 to 1796. Before she selected Judge as her principal attendant, Martha Washington had long admired her skills in weaving cloth, spinning thread, and making clothes. She made clothes for George and Martha Washington and their slaves at Mount Vernon, George Washington's Virginia plantation. At Mount Vernon, Judge also made soap, churned butter, dipped candles, washed clothes, and prepared meals. In 1789, when Judge was about 15 or 16 years old, Martha Washington selected her as her body servant. Martha Washington was now the first lady, and she and the newly elected president were preparing to move to the official presidential residence in New York, then the nation's capital. From 1790 to 1800, Philadelphia was the nation's capital. When the president and Mrs. Washington moved to the president's house in Philadelphia in November 1790, they took Judge and some other enslaved Africans with them. Judge's mother was the Mount Vernon slave seamstress, Betty. Judge's father was Andrew Judge, a white indentured servant from Leeds, England, who had come to America in 1772. He was a tailor at Mount Vernon. After 4 years there, Judge gained his freedom while Betty and his daughter remained enslaved. No images of Ona Judge are known to exist, but she was light-skinned because of a white contemporary of hers who had visited the Washington's main house noted that all the slaves laboring there had a skin color like a white person. As Washington's chief body servant, Judge helped her to bathe and dress and undress. She also combed her hair and starched the cap she always wore on her head. When Washington visited her female friends and acquaintances who were the wives of influential men, she took Judge with her. While Washington was meeting her social obligations, Judge passed her time in the kitchen talking with the slaves and hired help. At the president's house in Philadelphia, President Washington signed the Fugitive Slave Act of 1793 into law. It allowed slave owners to recapture their slaves, go to a local court in the state of recapture, present proof of ownership, and be issued a certificate permitting them to take their slaves back into bondage. The law also imposed a $500 fine on anyone who tried to help a slave escape or tried to hinder the efforts of anyone who was trying to recover the slave. Following the March 1796 marriage of her granddaughter, Elizabeth Curtis, Martha Washington told Judge that she would be a wedding gift to the newlywed couple. They had honeymooned at the Washington's residence. Not wanting to be a slave all her life, Judge decided to try to escape from the northern city of Philadelphia rather than try to escape from Mount Vernon, where the Washingtons would return in 1797 when George Washington's presidency ended. Judge had friends among the free blacks in Philadelphia. Someone either slave or free carried her packed clothes out of the president's house prior to her escape. She fled in May or June of 1796 as the Washingtons were eating dinner. She hid in a house in Philadelphia until blacks directed her to the sailing vessel Nancy, which landed in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. In Portsmouth in January 1797, Judge married Jack Staines, a black sailor. They had three children, Eliza, Nancy, and William. After Staines died in 1803, Ona Marie Judge Staines, as she was then known, worked briefly as a maid in a private residence. As a slave, she was most likely called Oni, but she preferred the name Ona. But soon she and her children moved to Greenland, New Hampshire, and became boarders in the home of a black family named Jacks. Judge's children died before she did. As she aged, doing manual labor to earn money was not possible. The Jacks' daughters with whom she had continued to board were also aged. The women survived because of the community of Greenwood, which had very few blacks, gave them wood for fuel and food. Despite the hardship of her life, in an interview printed in a New Hampshire newspaper in 1845, Judge said that she never regretted seizing her freedom. She died in Greenland on February 25th, 1848. Because of the Fugitive Slave Act of 1793, she was a fugitive for the last 52 years of her life.